give you
Father
some.
God, we thank you for this morning. It's cold morning. We thank you that we're here. We thank you for this winter. And it is supposed to be cold. And we rejoice in you for giving us season. So we just pray that the words that are spoken today, that they would be placed in our minds and our hearts. Because your word says that when that happens, it's to help us to not sin against you, to help us to know your word so we can live it. And I just pray today that the word is spoken, that it does soak into our minds, and that it does soak into our hearts, so that we can be a useful people, so we can be a strong people, a strong example for you. And we pray that the songs that are lifted up, that they just will be pleasing to your ear, Father. So we give you all the praise and thank you.
amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, would lay down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. It breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. His amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Brings the chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shoots like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy. Amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. My hand, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we sing. Everyone sing. And lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we sing. Everyone sing.
Your feet like an alabaster jar. Every piece of who I am is laid before Your Majesty. I will bow my at Your feet, at Your feet. My lips so lost for words will kiss Your feet, will kiss Your feet. And know the gravity of You draws my soul unto its knees. And I will never be the same, oh no, as I am lost and found in You. So I will bow my life at Your feet, at Your feet. There lost chords. I'll kiss your feet. I'll kiss your feet. So I will bow my life at your feet. At your feet. My lips so lost chords. Kiss your feet, oh, kiss your feet.
You know, last week we looked at Scripture and the accuracy of Scripture. Spent a good bit of time on that. And I wanted to just make a clarification this morning in case I'd said something that I didn't mean to say. But someone had said to me last week about the fact that that I'd said that there were errors in the Bible. And if I said that, that's not what I meant. What I said and meant to say was that there are errors in the manuscripts of which the Bible was made. The fact that we are able to take all of those manuscripts and put them together, we're able to find which are the errors so they aren't included in the Scripture. And so that is what, if I said something other than that, that was that's not what I intended. I believe that the Scripture is accurate, and don't want to put out the idea that it is not. Today we're going to start a new series, and I say this every time we start a new series, but I mean this, and that is I'm excited about the series. And we're going to be looking at the book of Acts, and if you don't know, the book of Acts is a history book. It is a history of the beginning of the church. And so it begins in about the year 30, 32, something like that, because it begins at the resurrection of Christ. And then it extends for 30 years into the beginning of the church. So it is from about 32 to about 62 AD is the time period covered. And so we're going to see that there's extraordinary things happen in that time, and the church grows like crazy during that time period. And so we're going to try to look at the book of Acts through that lens, through the idea of the beginning of the church and what caused the church to grow, why it grew so exponentially at that time in history. There were approximately 120 believers when Jesus went to the cross. So think about that, 120 believers. If you want just a little bit of perspective on that, when we began our ministry here, I think the first week we were here together, there were 119. So almost almost precise there, almost exactly. And so 120 people at the time that Jesus resurrected. By the time that 30-year period ended, the book of Acts, now we don't have precise numbers, but they're able to kind of calculate, kind of figure. It is determined there were probably 100,000 believers in the world in those 30 years. Now think about that. What if we did that? What if we started with 119 people in 2009, and then in 2039, there were 100,000 of us? Wouldn't that be amazing? But that is how much the church grew. By the end of the first century, there were, depending on who you whose numbers you follow, approximately 500,000 believers. From 120 to 500,000 in approximately 100 years. And so what we want to look at and think about, if that kind of growth happens, if that is possible to produce that many new believers, then we got to figure out what they did so that we can do that very thing. So that we can replicate what happened in that first century church, in the New Testament church. Today, when I use the term church growth, we probably think in a different way. We generally, when people start talking about church growth, and if I stood up here and I said, we're going to really work on church growth, our thoughts would immediately go to, okay, how do we get more people in this building? And that has been the focus of church growth in recent years. You could go on Amazon and search church growth, and all these books will come up on how you can grow your church. And so we're going to look at that, but we're going to look at it probably in a different way. Because church growth in the New Testament, in the book of Acts, is not church growth like we think of in those terms. Church growth in the New Testament is as we study the book of Acts, the primary understanding is different. Growing the church in the first century was more concerned with growing the number of churches than they were growing in the number in the churches. It wasn't so much concerned with, we got to get more people in this building, we got to get more buildings, we got to get more churches. And that became the means to growth. That became the way that the church grew so rapidly and so quickly. And the reason is probably this. In the New Testament church, it wouldn't have been wise to try to get as many people together at the same time every week. We're going to meet every Sunday, 9 o'clock in Jerusalem. Because in those days, they were heavily persecuted. And so if it was published, if it was known, everybody's going to get together at this time, it would be a field day for the Roman officials. They could have walked right in and hauled away whoever they wanted. And so the church began much differently. And it was interesting, in the early service, there were 11 of us today. And that's counting the preacher. And so that is probably what the New Testament church looked like. 11 people gathered in a house together. And so we want to grow the church. We want more believers. We don't invite more people into our gathering. We go and we build another church. We start another church across town. And that is how the church grew. Churches, after one after the other. And so as we walk through the book of Acts, we're going to see that Paul is going to be the church planter. He's going to be the one that does it. And he moves from community to community, starts a church, works with that church, disciples that church, moves on and does the same thing over again someplace else. That is the New Testament model for church growth. And so over the last 100 years, we've kind of, I think, got away from that. We've got it backwards. We've got to thinking, well, we got to get more people into this church. In fact, we don't need another church. We don't need to build another church because we got enough room here, right? And so we're satisfied with that. And yet in the New Testament, that's not the way they worked. They didn't wait till they filled up the building. They went somewhere else and they started a church someplace else. And that became the means to growing the church. Over the last 50 to 75 years, we kind of got away from that. The primary means to church growth became like crusade evangelism. You know, bring Billy Graham to town, have a Heaven's Gates event, or as many of us maybe were saved at a revival. And that became the means to church growth. And that whole thing was intended to bring more people into your particular fellowship, your particular building. But I want you to think about this. When you look at our area and you consider how churches grew, how they came to bring more people to Christ, it was because every little community had a church. And so if I can use the Methodist church as an example, because they were very, very instrumental in that in our area. They would come into Huntingdon County and they would put a couple churches in the town of Huntingdon. And they'd go to Mount Union, they'd put one in Mount Union. And then they'd go out Hill Valley and put one in Hill Valley, and a couple in Harris Valley, and one in Smith Valley, and four in Trough Creek Valley, and one in Saltillo, and one in Three Springs, and one in Orbazonia. And so these churches all over the place. And somebody might have said, well, why? Why do you need one in Saltillo? You got one in Three Springs. And yet that is the way that they ministered, and that's the way the church grew and came to make more and more disciples. And so we got away from that. We left that formula and thought that the more effective formula was crusade evangelism or personal evangelism or whatever model you would choose. But I think as we look at it, we see that there are limits to the effectiveness of those other types of evangelism. That historically speaking, that church planting has been more effective form of evangelism and church growth. And not only that, it's the New Testament model. It's how they did it in the first century when they brought the church from 120 to 100,000 people. And so I think this is an appropriate time for us to look at this, because we're ready to take a big venture. We're ready to make a move here. We're ready to open up another building, another facility. And one of the things I've heard is, well, why would we need to do that? You know, we got enough room here, or we can open up over there and then we could close this one. And yet that's contrary to the New Testament. That's not how they did it. They didn't open a church in order to close another church. They didn't build a bigger church so they could consolidate all their other churches. They just built more churches. And God used that to grow the church in a major way. You know, as I think about what we face, I mean, I think just about everybody's excited about this. I mean, as we get closer and closer to the day where we start actually working on the building, closer and closer to the day we actually use the building, I think everybody's getting excited, but we need to, come on, there's some apprehension, right? There's some trepidation that we enter this because this is a big financial investment. It's going to take a lot of work. It's going to take a lot of people. It's going to take a lot in order for this to happen. And so as we approach that, I think it is of great benefit for us to consider the story from the book of Acts, the history of the church, when the church went from a handful to a 500,000. And so we'll go through the entire book with that in mind. If you've ever seen the movie Field of Dreams, there's that famous scene in the movie where Kevin Costner's walking in his cornfield. He owns this farm and he's about ready to lose the farm because of finances. And he's walking in the cornfield and he hears a whisper, a voice, and it says, If you build it, he will come. And he kind of thinks he's like losing his mind or something. He yells to his wife, hey, did you hear that voice? And she's like, no, dear, I didn't hear anything. And he hears it again, and he hears it again. And the whole thing is, and the premise of the movie is that if he builds a ball field on his farm there, that people are going to come. And that's how the movie plays out. And so the question is, as we read the New Testament and we read the New Testament church, is that true? Is it true for that? That if we build it, they'll come? Because that seems to be the case. It seems to be in the New Testament, they went into a community, they established a church, and they came. It grew. And spread the Christianity all over the modern world at that time. Well, I'm going to say this up front, that isn't necessarily true for our church. We can't simply say, if we build it, they'll come. That's all it's going to take. We put the facility there, and God will put the people in there. We can't consider that. Because there's more to it than that. And I think as we look at the book of Acts, we're going to see in the first 11 verses of Acts chapter 1, he's going to establish, here's what has to be present. Here's are the things that are foundational to your church and the success of your church. Sure, you build it and they will come if these other things are true. If we are true to the principles that were foundational, that I think are found in the first 11 books, or 11 books, 11, first 11 verses of Acts chapter 1, I believe that they will come. And so we're going to look at this today. We're going to look at the foundational elements to church growth according to the book of Acts, according to the first 11 verses in Acts chapter 1. So we're going to open up Acts chapter 1 and read those first 11 verses. But before we do, let's pray together. Father, thank you today that we can be together in just the warmth of this building. I thank you, God, for your faithful followers who come today, Lord, braving the elements, maybe even dangerous situations. I thank you, God, just for protecting my wife and daughter as they had a little accident this morning on the way here. And God, we thank you for just the faithfulness that brings us together on this day. And pray now, Lord, as we have the opportunity to open your word, that God, you would minister to us, you would speak to us, and God, you would equip us for the task that you have before us. Use your word, Lord, to prepare us in every way for what we will be facing in the next few months. We just thank you. We look forward to whatever it is you're going to do in us this morning, and we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, Acts chapter 1, reading through the first 11 verses. Here's what it says. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach, until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. After he had said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. And so we open up in verse 1, and we hear a name maybe that we're not familiar with, and it is the name Theophilus. But it is a clue to us, because we could read the book of Acts and not know who wrote the book of Acts, because he doesn't refer to himself other than to simply refer to himself as me, in referring to his companionship with Paul, his work in the mission, the ministry of the Apostle Paul. But we can find out who it is because of the letter referring to Theophilus. And he says this, in my former book, as in speaking to Theophilus, he says, in my former book, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach. And so here's what we know. This guy that wrote the book of Acts wrote another book in the Bible. And so that book is actually the book of Luke. And in Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, it says this. Many have undertaken to draw up an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the first were eyewitnesses and servants of the word. Therefore, since I myself have carefully investigated everything from the beginning, it seemed good also to me to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you might know, that you may know the certainty of the things that you have been taught. So we know from the book of Acts, or from the book of Luke, that the writer of the book of Acts is the same as the writer of Luke, and that would be Luke. And so Luke is the writer, and we often make the mistake, a lot of people in the church make this mistake, so if you've made this mistake, you're in good company, and that is to think that Luke is a disciple, one of the early disciples of Jesus, and yet he wasn't. But Luke was one of the missionary companions of Paul, and was a Gentile, was saved probably as a result of the church being scattered. And so Luke was a missionary who never really met Jesus in person, and yet he took the time to write the gospel, probably from his interaction with those who had come in contact with Jesus. He took and he wrote down what he calls an orderly account of those things. And so Luke wrote the gospel, and now he's continuing to tell that story. Remember, the gospel end in Mark, we looked at last week, ends with this kind of up-in-the-air ending, and now we get to Acts, and he begins right where the gospel left off. And so the written by Luke, written to Theophilus, who we'll look at in just a moment. But here's how Irenaeus, the early church history forefather, wrote. He described Luke in this way. Luke is a man from Antioch, Syria, a physician by profession. He was a disciple of the apostles, and later he accompanied Paul until his martyrdom. Having neither wife nor child, he served the Lord without distraction. He fell asleep in Boeotia. Now, and fell asleep would actually mean that he died. At the age of 84, full of the Holy Spirit, moved by the Holy Spirit, Luke composed all of this gospel in the districts around Achaia. So that's what we know about Luke. Paul spoke of Luke in his letters. If we would write the epistles that Paul has written to other people, he'll mention Luke. So we can put those things together and find Luke wrote the book of Acts. And he was a companion of Paul on his missionary journeys. And so Theophilus, who's this guy? Well, Theophilus only appears in two places in the Bible. He appears in Acts chapter 1, and he appears in Luke chapter 1. That's the only mention of Theophilus, and so we don't know exactly who Theophilus is. It's speculated, based on his name, it's speculated that he was a Roman official of some sort that became a follower of Jesus. But here's another theory. That's the general majority opinion about Theophilus. But here's another view that some people have. The word Theophilus means friend of God. And so in writing this letter, he says this, most excellent friend of God, and then he continues on. Some people believe that he wasn't speaking specifically to an individual, but to whoever was a disciple of Christ who would happen to pick up this letter. And so he was writing it to you today. He's saying, most excellent friend of God. And then here's the story that constitutes the beginning of the church in the New Testament. And it really isn't critical. It's just one of those fun little information things that we have, but it isn't critical to the story whether we know who Theophilus is. But verse 2 then says this, until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. Okay, here we go. We're going to start. What are the foundational truths? What are the things that we have to take to the ministry that is Trough Creek, the ministry that is here in Saltillo, the ministry that is our mission trips, the ministry that is our youth group and our encore ministry and anything else? What are those things that have to be a part of it, that those ministries have to be built upon? The first thing is this, the foundation of church growth is in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He begins with that. The Gospels end with Jesus died on the cross, Jesus rose, Jesus spoke with the disciples, and now Acts begins at that point. And the first thing that he tells us about is the resurrection of Jesus. Look, everything that we do here, if that is not true, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, then this is pointless. This would be a complete waste of time, because that's what the Bible says. And everything we do and everything we say is based on the truth of the resurrected Christ. And so that has to be a part of who we are. That is the foundation of the church, that Jesus didn't stay dead, that Jesus rose again. And so that is foundational to church growth. It's interesting that after his salutation, the first words out of his mouth, first words out of Luke's mouth speak of confirming the historical truth of Christ's resurrection. He begins with that, I believe, because if that is not true, then nothing else that follows is going to matter. It's going to be of no significance. And then on verse 4, he says this, on one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised. Jesus begins with very specific instructions. And those instructions are basically, okay, wait. Don't do anything, just wait. There's a promise coming, you need to wait on that. When that happens, then you can move forward. But right now, wait. Don't do anything. Now, that goes probably contrary to everybody's thoughts. That would go contrary to us. When we think we know what's next, the last thing we want to do is wait. I want to go. I want to proceed. I want to pursue. I want to do whatever it is that you want me to do. I got to go now. And so if that would have happened in that New Testament church, they would have been leaving without the gift that was intended to make their mission possible, and that was the Holy Spirit. And so he says, just wait. Wait until this happens. Don't go pushing ahead. Don't move out in your own power and ability. You see, it was going to be critical that they listen to Jesus, that they obey Jesus. That obedience to the teachings of Jesus Christ is foundational to church growth. We will, as a church, succeed in effectively planting another church or growing our ministries or growing this church, this particular church here, to the degree that we remain faithful to the teachings of Christ. Obedience. We stand here every week. We just went through the book of Mark. Mark is predominantly the teachings of Christ. It's the things about Jesus, the things that Jesus said, the things that Jesus taught. So I stand up here every week and I tell you, here's what Jesus said. Here's what Jesus expects of you. This is what Jesus wants of you. And so what is our response to that? It should be obedience. It should be simply listening to what he says and doing what he says. And not neglecting anything, not leaving out the things that we're not comfortable with, the things that we don't like, the things that our culture doesn't like today, but telling fully, completely what it is that Jesus expects of us and then being obedient to that. You know, I really believe that churches are slowly dying in our community, and this is the primary reason. Neglecting the obedience to the teachings of Christ. You are sitting in a church that died 10 years ago. A church that eventually closed the doors because nobody was here anymore. There was not a ministry here anymore, and they closed the doors. What a sad testimony of the fact that, you know, this was probably one of the first churches in South Tolo. And a part of the Methodist movement that led to a great evangelism in this part of the world. And yet it died. And when I look at the church today and I see churches are still dying, there's still many churches are just, the only thing that keeps them gone is the people that have been gone there for 50 years, and when they're gone, the church is gone. And I really believe that it's because people have walked away from the obedience to the teachings of Christ. Jesus has said, this is what I want you to do, this is what I expect for you, and as we walk away from that, the church will slowly die. And you know what our response to that usually is? It isn't to come back into obedience to Christ, it's to try to adjust in some way. You know what the problem is? We need new worship music. We need a contemporary service. If we do that, that'll bring life back to this church. Churches aren't dying because of the type of worship music. Churches are dying because they're not being obedient to the words and teachings of Christ. And so as we move on and establish new ministries, we have to be faithful and obedient to what Christ has instructed us to do. Verse 5 then says this, for John baptized with water, but in a few days you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Verse 4, he says, wait, don't do anything until you receive the gift that has been promised. Verse 5, here's the gift, the Holy Spirit. Now, when he first said, when you get that gift that I promised, of course, it followed immediately that he said it was the Holy Spirit. But I don't know that the disciples would even know what he was talking about. When the gift comes, they'd have been like, what gift? What's he talking about? But remember earlier in the Gospels, when Jesus had said that I have to go, but the Father is going to send a comforter. The Father is going to send this gift. And so he says, it's the Holy Spirit. And so he reveals the gift that Jesus had promised as being the Holy Spirit. The foundation of church growth is found in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Here's our tendency. When we've got work to do, when we have ministry to do, I'm going to use all the abilities that God has given me. I'm going to use my strengths, everything that way God has made me, that are my abilities that I can contribute to this, and I'm going to pour myself into making that happen. And if I do that, I might experience a little bit of success. I might accomplish a little bit, but it's very limited because I'm doing it in my own ability. And that's why Jesus said, don't go anywhere. Stay here till you get the Spirit. Because if he had sent them out at that point, they'd have been all back by evening. And they would have packed it up and they'd have went home. And they would have been done. But because they were given the Spirit, we see that those disciples who cowered in the garden were standing in the streets of Jerusalem, preaching to the very people that crucified Jesus. And it's because they had received the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit was now the one that was working in and through them. The Holy Spirit was what was accomplishing great things in the growth of that early church. Verse 6 and 7 says, so when they met together, they asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it's not for you to know the times and dates the Father has set by his own authority. Do you see this? Do you hear this? Is this not like the same old disciple story here? What is the kingdom? What about the kingdom? When are you going to set up the kingdom? And then when we looked at the Olivet Discourse, it was the same thing. What about the kingdom? When are you setting it up, right? They're still thinking in terms of earthly kingdom, that Jesus is going to set up the kingdom. I mean, he's here saying, look, I'm going to send your spirit, and then you're going to do some awesome things. And they're like, okay, but what about the kingdom? And because they are still completely on their own plan, their own agenda. They're still seeing things completely from the way they want to see it happen, the way they want to see it unfold. And so they are still working to their own agenda. Placing God's will above our own will is foundational to church growth. Look, this is hard for me. This is when I look, and if you're on your YouVersion app this morning, one of the poll questions is, which of these do you struggle with? This is mine. I don't say that to influence you and your decision. You need to decide for yourself. But, okay, I got a plan. I've got an agenda. And I think it's awesome. In fact, if I were to talk with all you, I'm certainly going to walk away with, well, my plan is better. The scheme that I've got together is better. And so I want to move my agenda forward. I want to move my plan forward. That's how we are. That's our natural tendency. And yet we need to be able to step back and set aside our own will, our own agenda, and allow God's agenda to proceed. Let that to direct us. And so these disciples who think, okay, the kingdom, we're ready to set it up. We're ready to get this earthly kingdom rolling. And Jesus is like, look, don't even worry about that. Don't even think about that at this time. That God's got that. God the Father has that taken care of. We might have the greatest ideas in the world. We might have a plan that seems flawless. It's been checked off by all the famous preachers and church growth guys. And yet, if it isn't God's plan, it will crash and burn. We might look at the Trough Creek facility and think we've got the most awesome, perfect plan in place for using that building. If it's not God's plan, it's not going to work. It might appear to work for a little while, but it will not, in the long run, continue to be of benefit. We need to place God's will above our own. That's hard. That's hard for me to step aside and recognize that not every idea I have comes directly from God. Some of it comes just from my own desires and my own heart. Verse 8 then says this, and this is one of my favorite passages in Scripture, but it says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. When I look back over my life and I think, if someone would ask me 30 years ago what my favorite Bible verse was, I would have been able to give you something. And when I first started in ministry, I'd have had one for you. And then a little bit later, it's all because it's so relevant to where I am at that particular point in my life. But when I see this verse, this is like one of my favorites. I think this is an incredible promise. And it's not even a request. It's a statement of fact. He doesn't say, will you be my witnesses, or you might be my witnesses. He said, you will be my witnesses. He is telling them in advance what's going to happen, that they will be his witnesses once they receive the Spirit. And so look what their ministry is. And we look at this and we consider in this whole 11 verses, and Jesus is instructing them and commanding them. This is the only thing he tells them to do. He tells them to wait, but this is the only ministry thing he gives to them. And it is simply this, witnessing. You know what that is? What does a witness do? If you're a witness in a court of law, you go in and you tell the story. You tell the story from your perspective. Well, I was sitting at the corner of Mifflin and 7th Street, and this car came through, and this is what I saw. This is what I know to be true. And so we are told we are going to be his witnesses. He told the disciples, you're going to be his witness. What's he saying? You're going to tell the story. You're going to tell the story that you know, the story that is your story, the personal story. And so as we consider our ministry and beginning a new church, sharing the gospel story is foundational to church growth. Telling people the story. Now, when I say the gospel story, I'm not talking about that little, I'm a sinner. Jesus died for my sins. I put my faith in him. I'm saved. you know, the kind of how we wrap the gospel, the good news up in just that little narrative. The good news, the gospel story begins at Genesis and ends with Revelation. It's the whole story. Genesis tells us how we got lost. And Revelation tells us the glory of what all this ends. And that whole thing is the gospel story. And so as we gather together each week, I hope you see and understand that that is primary to who we are, telling the story. We come together to tell the story, and you go from here to tell the story. In fact, as he shares this, he tells them, he's speaking to them individually, as individuals, and he says, you are going to be my witnesses. You're going to go from here, and you're going to tell the story. John Wesley has this quote that's on your bulletin. He says, I look on all the world as my parish. Thus far, I mean, that in whatever part of it I am, I judge it meet, right, and my bounden duty to declare unto all that are willing to hear the glad tidings of salvation. John Wesley is saying this, my parish isn't simply this church. It isn't this collection of churches. It is wherever I am. Wherever God has placed me at this moment, that's where I'm supposed to be telling the story. That's where I'm supposed to be sharing that truth with other people. And so we come together as believers, as a missional church, and you are going to go from here, and you are going to be his witnesses. You are going to tell the story to other people. That's really being a disciple in the most basic understanding. That witness, that person who shares the story. And then he tells them something that would have probably seemed impossible to them. In fact, it would have been impossible if they were going on their own without the Holy Spirit. But he says to them, you know what? You're not going to be my witnesses simply here in your hometown of Jerusalem, but you're going to be my witnesses in Judea. That's the country that they live. All of Judea, he says. And not only that, you're going to be my witness in Samaria. That's the country that was next door. And you're going to be my witnesses to the end of the earth. Now, in those days, you know, the modern world would have been small in terms of what it was populated and people lived. But still, to get from one end to the end, from where you were to the end of the earth, you're talking months journey. And so for a person in the New Testament time, in that first century, to hear, well, you know, you're going to take the gospel to the ends of the earth, you'd be like, no, that's not going to happen. There's no way. There's no way I'm going to be able to do that. And yet, that's what happened. And so, if you're looking at your life, and you're looking at the people that are within your reach, you see, here's the people that are within my reach. And then there are those that are out of my reach. What you're doing is you're limiting God. You're putting a boundary. You're saying, okay, this is how far it'll go. This is how far I can reach the world with the message that I've been given. And yet, God or Jesus speaking to the disciples says there is no limit. That, in fact, you know the limit? I'll decide that. Jesus will decide that. I'll decide where the boundary is, where the limit is. In fact, you look at the story, and we'll walk through the book of Acts, and we'll see this. They got real comfortable sharing that message right there in Jerusalem. They were growing. It was effective, but they were happy there. And then what started? Persecution. And that persecution pushed them into other places to share the gospel. As I was preparing this, I was thinking about this truth. And the fact is that almost everybody who's a part of this church came from a different church. Something happened, and I don't know if persecution's the right word, but something happened in your church that pushed you someplace else. And your life is a microcosm of what happened in the book of Acts. Persecution pushed them out. And it pushed them out to somewhere else where there was another group of people that needed reached. Ultimately, it pushed them out of Judea. It pushed them into Samaria. It pushed them into Antioch, where the first Gentile church was found. In fact, Luke was from Antioch. Luke was probably saved as a result of the persecution that pushed the disciples into Syria at that time in history. Church growth is realized when we remove the self-imposed limits on our ministry. Quit looking at your life and thinking, this is as far as it'll go. This is where my boundary is. This is the limits to my ministry. God has the ability to push you someplace else, to take you somewhere you couldn't imagine. I would never imagine that I've had an opportunity to preach in South America on numerous occasions, in Central America. I would never have thought that. I would never believe that. We have a ministry of our sermons, our messages go on the internet. That means what? There are no limits, you know? It'll go wherever their Wi-Fi is available, which frankly is everywhere anymore. And so what God can do, the way that God can use you to take that to places you never dreamed possible. And we need to make sure that we are not self-imposing limits on our ability to take the message. As we enter into this new stage of ministry, I want you to remind me and help me not to put limits on what this ministry can accomplish. To not think, oh, that's not going to work, or there's no way. That's impossible, because I am sure that when Jesus shared these words in the beginning, I'm sure there were people like whispering, oh, yeah, right, like that's going to happen. You know, Jesus can accomplish whatever Jesus wants to accomplish. Verses 9 through 11 then close out the text, and it says this. After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid them from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside him. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. You know, I really like this. I think this is a cool picture. Because they're like standing there like looking up, probably amazed at what they're seeing. And just caught up in what's happening. And then these guys show up and they're like, you know what? What are you looking at? Why are you looking up there? He left. He's coming back. He'll be back eventually. You know what I think he's saying? You need to stop watching and you need to start doing. There's no sense standing here looking. He could have said, it's going to be over 2,000 years before he comes back. You might as well do something while he's away. And so stop watching and start working. Start doing what it is that Jesus just told you to do. You know, that is a big problem for us today. You know, we have a tendency to want to watch. And you might say, how do we watch? I'm not standing looking at the heavens waiting for Jesus to come back. Well, we watch by this. We come to church and we watch the preacher preach a message. We watch our favorite TV preacher, I don't know. Whatever it is you're watching, you're watching somebody else work. You're watching somebody else do ministry. And then you leave, you go home, and that's it. And you come back next week and you watch again. And when we get into a ministry of watching, I'm listening, I'm hearing, I'm thinking about this, I'm learning about this. And yet, there comes a time when we stop watching and we start working. We start doing the things that God has instructed us and given us to do. And I don't say that simply to point at people who sit in the pews, but I'm guilty of that. You simply listen to me. You watch me and you listen to me and maybe don't do it. I say those words. I preach it and then I don't do it. I'm as guilty as you. But we need to get to that point where we're no longer content just to hear someone talk about it or watch somebody else, but actually get out there and do the task, to do the things that God has instructed us to do. Church growth is realized when God's people stop watching and start working. And so as we look at this task before us regarding this facility, I'm absolutely amazed at the number of people who have gotten involved and are doing things that you aren't even aware of. Things that they're working on, researching chairs, working on what the carpet or what the flooring is going to look like, the color schemes, things that you don't know people are even thinking about that are people are working on, and guys that are evaluating the heating system, all this stuff that's going on that most people aren't even aware of. But all of us have a part to play in this, and it requires all of us to be obedient and be involved in whatever it is. And, and it's not just about Trough Creek. It's about everything we might do as a ministry. I really believe that God, in these 11 verses, lays the foundation for what will be the New Testament church. If you build it, will they come? Yeah, if these things are a part of the foundation. If you build it upon this foundation, they will come. And you will have an effective ministry. You will touch people's lives in ways you can't imagine. If these are left out, we might build a nice building, and that's all it's going to be. It's not going to accomplish anything of great importance or of any eternal significance. But if we adhere to these truths, God will use this building, this ministry, whatever ministry it is you're involved in, for His good and for His glory, to build His church, to bring people to Christ. Let's pray together. Father, thank You today. Just love this passage of Scripture. And pray, God, that this becomes foundational for us as we venture in this new ministry. Lord, when we begin to veer away from these things, when we begin to put other things in priority over these things, God, bring us back to this. Remind us of these truths. We thank You, and we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand.
Saying yes to You and no to my desires, I'll leave myself behind and follow You. I'll walk the narrow road, 'cause it leads me to You. I'll fall, but grace will pick me up again. I've counted up the cost. I've counted up the cost. Yes, I've counted up the cost, and You are worth it. I do not need safety as much as I need You. You're dangerous, but Lord, You're beautiful. I'll chase You through the pain, and I'll carry my cross. 'Cause real love is not afraid to bleed. I've counted up the cost. Oh, I've counted up the cost. Yes, I've counted up the cost, and You are worth it. I've counted up the cost. Oh, I've counted up the cost. Yes, I've counted up the cost, and You are worth it. So Jesus, take my all, take my everything. I've counted up the cost, and You're worth every day. Jesus, take my all, take my everything.
life counts it up through cost, and you're worth every day. I've counted up the cost. Oh, I've counted up the cost. Yes, I've counted up the cost, and you are worth it.
Let's pray. Father, thank you today just for our time together. And God, as we look at this challenge that faces us, and we're confronted with the truth of a New Testament example, Lord, that will bring success to the ministry, that would make certain that we're not doing anything without purpose, without any use, Lord. We're going to accomplish great things for you, Lord, when we remain faithful to the principles of Scripture, to the truth that is established here in the book of Acts. And I pray, God, before we do that, before we take one step in that direction, that, God, we would count the cost of that. We would understand that it isn't easy, that there's pain, there's difficulty, there's challenge in that. But God, when we follow you faithfully, when we are obedient to you, God, what is most important is you will bring glory and you will bring goodness in the work that we do. Thank you, Lord, for our time together today. We just pray your greatest and best blessing on your people here as we go from here, Lord, as we go into our Jerusalem, into our Judea, into our Samaria, as we go to the ends of the earth, Lord, for you and your purposes. We thank you, and we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.